Hi everybody, welcome back to another awesome day, another awesome vlog. Today I am going to talk a little bit more about some of the things that I've learned in my life skills class, and one of the things we're going to talk about today is communication. Yes, I said communication because that is one of the things that we are the worst at. We are so good at pointing the finger and saying, you did this and you did that, instead of communicating how we really, really feel, thinking it through before we speak, and making a clear point. So, we have a couple of other things we're gonna talk about, but let's get started with communication. There is a way that we should communicate. This is something anyways that I'm learning in my class, and it's called the communication model. There are three parts to it. So the first part is you should say to whoever you are wanting to communicate a point to, when I blank. In that blank, you're going to fill in one of the five senses: saw, heard, touched, felt, or smelled. So one of your five senses will go in that blank. The second part, and when I'm finished, I'll give you a full example of a way that you can complete this communication process. The second part is, what I made up about that is blank. This is where you are going to put in what went on in your head, what you thought about, your storyland, because we always make up stories in our mind and turn things into something that they actually aren't in our heads and cause us stress and anxiety. But in this section, you are not going to say you. You are not going to make this about the other person. You're going to make it about yourself. And the third part of the communication model is, about that I felt blank. And you're going to fill in a one-word feeling, such as sad, happy, angry, hurt. So here is an example. A husband and wife have been struggling to get along, but they've both been making great, great strides and trying really hard. So the wife comes home and she decides that she's gonna cook a very, very special dinner for her husband and make it a really, really nice romantic evening. So she's at home cooking dinner, waiting for her husband to come home from work. He comes through the front door and the front door slams. Instantly in her mind, she thinks that something must be wrong and he must be upset. She turns the stove off, goes upstairs, locks herself in the room. The next day, she ends up going to the husband and deciding, I'm gonna talk to him about this and figure out where we went wrong. What did I do that made him so upset, that made him slam the door, so that I can be sure not to do it the next time? What she said to him when she got there was, when I heard the front door slam, what I made up about that was that I had done something wrong. And about that, I felt scared. The husband ended up letting her know that he actually had walked through the door with wine and roses and his hands were full. The wind caught the door and slammed the door, and it had nothing to do with him being upset. The point of this is, we all make things up in our minds. Something happens and we make up a story that leads us to believe that someone else is upset with us, that we've done something wrong. When really, if we would just learn how to properly communicate right away, we could take care of the situation and there would be no reason for us to be making up these stories in our heads and wondering what someone else is thinking. If you take the time to stop and think about your communication, and instead of always pointing the finger and saying, you did this and you did that, or you are always upset with me, or you are always having all of these problems, if instead we make it about ourselves and be able to communicate with the other person what we are feeling properly, the communication lines will be much more open. And if the wife had gone to the husband immediately and discussed what she experienced up in her head, she would have been able to have a wonderful conversation with her husband, gone back to making dinner, and they would have had a nice evening together. But instead, she went up to her room because of what she was thinking up in her head because of her own anxiety and stress, and made it a problem when there really was no problem at all. This was just an example. It was actually an example that was made in my class, and I thought it was a really, really good one. But if you use the communication model, that will help you communicate better with other people. It also helps you not point the finger. If you never say you and make it about the other person, it will allow them to sit back and go, oh, This person is going to take responsibility for what's going on in their head. It also gives you an opportunity to explain what you're thinking, because unfortunately it is something that most people do. You start thinking of a scenario up in your head and you turn it into something when there really was no problem to begin with. So get out of your head and work on better communication. One of the things that I learned in my class today is that 70% of the things that make us feel anxious never actually happen. They are things that we've made up in our head and things that we start worrying about, and they never happen, they never are a problem, and they were never anything that we should have worried about to begin with. When you start pointing the finger and saying you, it gives you a false sense of power. It makes you feel like you're the one in charge and you're pointing the finger at someone else, but it is a false sense of power. It really is not a true sense of power. It is actually pointing the finger at someone else and putting the blame on them that may be unnecessary. We need to retrain our brains to think, to properly communicate, and instead of pointing the finger, to think about our words before they come out of our mouth so that we can get our point across in a proper way instead of just upsetting the other person and turning it into a huge fight and argument. The few minutes it would take to think through what you're going to say before you actually say it to the other person could save you hours or days of fighting with someone because you said something without thinking first. We also need to remember that when we get into storyland up in our brains, and even sometimes when it comes out of our mouth, we tend to use the words always and never. Most of the time, those words are not accurate. It's very rare that something always happens or never happens. It's usually somewhere in between that maybe sometimes it happens or doesn't happen, but we have to be very careful not to use those two words unless they are very, very accurate, but that is rare. We tend to pull from those words when we get really, really mad and say, you always do this or you never do this. And most of the time, that is not accurate. The next thing we're going to talk about is communicating using the word no. A lot of us are very uncomfortable when someone asks us to help them with something or do something for them. It's very uncomfortable to say the word no when really you aren't able to do what they're asking you to do. You're not available. You just do it because you feel obligated. Unfortunately, when we are young, we hear the word no and we associate that in our own mind to usually mean something negative. For everybody, it could be different. But for example, if you ask your mother for something when you're a small child and she says no, we all up in our minds, even as small children, turn that no into meaning something. That then moves on with us down the line in our lives as we get older, and we have relationships with friends, family, and someone asks us to do something for them. It doesn't always mean that just because you have to say no every once in a while, that you have to have a reason or have an excuse that you can make up and give to them. You should always be able to have no as an option. For example, if someone comes to you and they need you to help them move, and it's on a weekend that you've already made other plans with friends and family, there are some people that will cancel their plans, and that's as well could be something that's very disappointing to the people that you already had plans with, and make changes to their plans in order to help their friend move because they feel obligated, because maybe the last time you moved, they were able to help you. However, you are allowed and you have to give yourself permission to say no if you are not available. You can, of course, always give them the option that if they want to change the dates and maybe give them some options of when you would be available to help them with that, that you would be able to do that, but that on that specific date and time, you already have a previously made obligation and you are not available. When someone asks us to help them with something or do something for them, of course, it's always nice to do that if you're available and you want to. But when we get in our heads and get up in storyland, we start making up reasons that, oh my goodness, if I say no, they're gonna think I'm not a good friend. They're gonna think that I don't wanna help them with this because I'd rather go have fun. They're gonna think that I wanna use them when I need them to help me, but when it comes to me helping them, that I'm just not interested. You need to get out of their yard and stay in your own yard. Stop making up things in your mind about what someone else is thinking. Instead of simply telling them how we feel, expressing the fact that, no, I'm not able to help you this weekend, I have other obligations, and moving on. They then have the right to go ask someone else to help them, Or if you want to offer another date and time that you may be available and don't already have plans, they're welcome to do that. But you always need to give yourself the right to say no. We also teach people that we are their only resource by always saying yes. People start becoming dependent on you when possibly it would be better for them to reach out to other people and not always depend on you. That can be a hardship on someone. If you are always feeling that you are the only person that's available to help a friend or a family member, that can start taking a toll on your health as well. You have to be able to have boundaries and set limits and say no when you are not available. And on the other end of it, when you ask someone for help, or if you ask them to do something for you and they say no, that they are not available, you have to accept, respect, and trust that that is their choice and that maybe they do have other plans and other obligations, instead of making up in your head why this person is saying no. We need to get out of storyland and into reality. There are 7 deadly relationship sins that I'm gonna go over with you. And when we don't tolerate others to say no, we are engaging in one of these 7 sins. This is generally our response to hearing someone say no. Number 1, I'm not important enough. Number 2, we judge others as self-centered. Number 3, we should all over people emotionally, externally, and internally, saying they should do this for us. If they were a good friend, they would be more likely to. They should be available to help me anytime I need them because I'm always available for them. We use the word should, and we should all over people when it is unnecessary. Number 4, we assume the person saying no is uncaring or unthoughtful. Number 5, we assume that the person is emotionally going to withdraw. Number 6, we're concerned that the person is now going to begin physically withdrawing. And number 7, we begin plotting how to get even. Like I said, if someone says no when you are asking them to help you with something, we have to remember to accept, respect, and trust their decision, and know that it doesn't always mean something bad. It could simply mean that they have plans or something else going on and they just aren't available. Take a moment and think before you communicate. This is all about proper communication and working hard to communicate with the people that you're in relationships with. This will help your relationships to thrive, and when you have good communication, it just makes life easier. So go out there, try some of these tips, try learning how to communicate properly, and hopefully that will help your relationships to grow stronger and help you to have a stronger bond with your spouse, your family members, your friends, anyone in your life that you value. Because if you step back and take a moment and think before you say something, you won't be spending days trying to apologize for the things that you said that you really didn't mean, but you just got so dysregulated that you didn't take a moment to stop and think first. I hope you enjoyed this video. I hope you learned something from it. Don't forget to smash the thumbs up button and don't forget to subscribe. Bye.